Good morning.
Good morning.
Now, I hope you don't get too nervous. Just come up. I've got this microphone in my hand again. I'm not going to run you through any kind of crazy gymnastics or warm-up exercises. I'll leave that to Dana. So, welcome to Community United Methodist. Community Church of Vincennes. See? You got to. You know, I haven't degaussed my head lately, so. But welcome, whether you're here in the congregation, watching online, and even watch later on YouTube, welcome to join us this morning. Announcements for the coming week. Today is the last day to order noodles. So if you need some for Thanksgiving yet, for Christmas, or any time in between, or any time of the year, place your order now. The shoe boxes, some are still available on the table in the narthex. They need to be returned next Sunday, November 12th. And Salvation Army bell ringing time is coming up, and our church has available time slots. They will be at Save-A-Lot again, as we have in the past, on Friday, December 15th from 2 to 4, and Saturday, December 16th from 2 to 6. And each time slot will only be for 30 minutes. So sign-up sheets are available at the Welcome Center. And Cheryl has a few announcements of her own.
Morning. First of all, I would like to let you know that the locks have been changed on the church building. And so if you have an old key, if you see me after church, I will take your old key and exchange it for a new one. We are limited to the amount of keys that we're giving out per the trustees. So we want to make sure that staff receives a key, also committee chairpersons, and obviously someone from the sound booth, because they typically are in early or come in through the week to take care of things. If you have questions, you can see me after church. That is just for the outside building doors. If you have a pavilion key, it's still okay, and anything within the building. So this is just the outside doors. And as of tomorrow, we should have a new code that I will get to everybody as needed. So just know that's happening. I have been asked yet again, because apparently I'm a great sales girl. I'll take shirt orders one more time. I've already had a couple people. So if you would like a church shirt, please see me. I'm going to take orders through November 19th, so this Sunday, next Sunday, and the Sunday after. And then, guys, I got to be done, because, you know, I got a life. No, I'm just kidding. Anyways, seriously, if you want to wear them, I'm going to get them. So they are available as they have been, and if you have questions, I'll be right outside near the Welcome Center right after church. And also, widows, I haven't forgotten you. I really haven't. I know we met a long time ago, and I said we wanted to start meeting, and then volleyball. And volleyball is now over. Today is not a good day for me to meet with you, but I'd like to meet next week after church, if we can just gather up here so we can finalize some plans. And if you have ideas of things we'd like to do together, then that would be great, too. So, in the meantime, hey, and I just want to say, too, there's a lot of shoeboxes left on that table, folks, and I believe we can do better. So on your way out the door today, take a shoebox or two. Have a blessed week.
All right. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer, shall we? Good morning, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Lord, we thank you once more for your grace. We thank you for your presence. We thank you, Lord, for the Holy Spirit that fills our heart and this place. Draw us close to you this morning. Help us to set aside our cares and concerns, to lay them, Lord, into your lap so that our focus can be upon you and you alone. You'll take care of all things. And so, Lord, we trust in you. We praise you. We thank you. In Jesus' holy name, amen.
Rising, let us join our voices together. And we gather together. You think about, why do we gather together? Well, to praise the Lord, but this song says we gather together to ask the Lord's blessing. and we know we have it, but he still wants to hear from us. So please lift your voices in praise.
We gather together to ask the Lord's blessing. He chastens and hastens his will to make known. The wicked oppressing now cease from distressing. Sing praises to his name. He forgets not his own. Beside us to guide us, our God with us joining, ordaining, maintaining his kingdom divine. So from the beginning, the fight we were winning, thou Lord wast on our side, all glory be thine. We all do extol thee, thou leader triumphant, and pray that thou still our defender wilt be. Let thy congregation escape tribulation, thy name be ever praised, O Lord, make us free.
You may be seated.
Come now to the time of praises and concerns. We have many praise of a good harvest and not very many accidents during this harvest time locally. I have a personal praise, guilty. My wife's here. It's been a hard 2 months for her to sit home and just watch and not be part of the congregation. With other concerns, Imogene Williams' funeral and fellowship dinner were here yesterday. Wonderful, longtime member of the congregation and lady. Pray for the family as they travel back to Texas and their other homes, wherever they may be. An MRI has indicated that Pastor Darren and Cheryl's great nephew has had an acute stroke, and continue prayers for Levi as he heals in the future. Praise the Lord. Lois Stevens' sister-in-law Lisa will be having an open heart surgery for an aortic valve replacement in Tampa on Monday. Janice Kellerson's been moved to a regular room. Her physical therapy is coming and seeks continued prayers for her recovery as well. Ray Tromley had his procedure done this last week and was successful. There will be another procedure, but Dellinger let me know that Ray had a reaction to some medication and had been taken to the ER yesterday, but he is back home and recovering. So any other concerns someone wants to lift up to the congregation? Then let's assume an attitude of prayer. Oh, that's right. We have some videos to watch that are a praise in and of themselves. So take it away, tech team.
Father Almighty, pour out your Holy Spirit on Evelyn Faye Bilski for the office and work of a deacon in Christ's Holy Church. Amen. Evelyn, take authority as a deacon to proclaim the word of God and to lead God's people in ministries of compassion and justice. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Father Almighty, pour out your Holy Spirit on Evelyn Faye Bilski for the office and work of an elder in Christ's Holy Church. Amen. Evelyn, take authority as an elder to preach the word of God, to administer the holy sacraments, and to order the life of the church. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Father Almighty, pour out your Holy Spirit on Morris Fred Rister for the office and work of a deacon in Christ's Holy Church. Amen. Fred, take authority as a deacon to proclaim the word of God and to lead God's people in ministries of compassion and justice. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Father Almighty, pour out your Holy Spirit on Morris Fred Rister for the office and work of an elder in Christ's Holy Church. Amen. Fred, take authority as an elder to preach the word of God, to administer the holy sacraments, and to order the life of the church. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Lord, in prayer. Lord, we thank you for giving us this day, this Sabbath day. From the moment we opened our eyes and saw the day as it was, the sun coming up over this horizon, to shine upon this land of ours, to see the fields glean from the harvest, to know that there will be food in the future. But we don't know what tomorrow brings, Lord. Tomorrow's Monday. Today will have been a memory. But what we do today prepares us for tomorrow. Our prayers, our commitments, our lives as we live them as brothers and sisters in Christ. How will we end this day? Will we have led others to you? Will we have let them know that you are alive? History says that you died that Friday afternoon on a hilltop on a cross. But Easter Sunday says you rose, spent time with your disciples, and then ascended back to heaven at the right hand of the God, our Father. This is the good news we are to share. How are we doing it? How bad are we doing it, Lord? Do we need to be spanked a little to wake up? Do you need to grab our arm and say, not that way, this way? But you are our Father, our Holy Father. And through all things, you love us. Though we are our sinful creation that you saw walk away that day in the garden, you loved us. You loved us through your Son coming to earth to save us. And all those who have gone before this that have been faithful to show us. We We pray, Lord, that those who come behind us will find us faithful also. We thank you for the healing of our friends and family. We pray, Holy Spirit, that you are there for those who are feeling lonely and depressed. We pray for those who are fighting for freedom. We pray for peace. Your peace passes understanding. And this world needs your peace so greatly. Help us this day, Holy Spirit, to walk and to truly live by the words that Jesus taught us those centuries ago. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
So let's take time now to give unto the Lord of our gifts and tithes and offerings as Dana leads us in one more song this morning here. Give thanks.
Reflect on what we've been given monetarily. We need to reflect on what the blessings we've been given overall, because we, everyone within the sound of my voice, are in an elite group, because all you have to do is look up any statistics about the world and how people live and the struggles they go through, and we are an elite group. And so we should be praising the Lord and giving thanks like never before. So let's lift our voices as people bring the tithes and offerings forward to give thanks.
With a grateful heart, give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich, because of what the Lord has done for us. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich, because of what the Lord has done for us. Give thanks.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, O creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Heavenly Father, once more we thank you for the great bounty with which you have filled our lives, and ask you to bless and multiply this offering to your service and to the building of your kingdom. In the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. and amen. And we're going to move right into the children's message this morning. So if the kids would like to come on down. And Lori's got a little something to share with you today.
Okay, they're getting here slowly. Takes those ones in the balcony a little longer to get down here. Okay, so I'm going to start out by reading you a short story from the Bible, okay? And this comes from Luke 17, 11 through 17. Now, on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus traveled along the borders between Samaria and Galilee. As he was going into the village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. They stood at a distance and called out in a loud voice, "Jesus, Master, have pity on us." When he saw them, he said, "Go, show yourselves to the priest." And as they went, they were cleansed. One of them, when he saw he was healed, came back praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. Did you hear that part? How many came back to thank Jesus?
One.
How many were healed?
Did you hear that?
How many were healed?
Three.
Nope.
Ten people were healed, but only one took the time to go back and thank Jesus. That doesn't sound right, does it? Shouldn't we always thank Jesus for everything? So this is November, right? What holiday do we have in November? Anybody know? We've scored. Yeah, very good. Say that loud.
Thanksgiving.
So we're done with Halloween, right? We had a great time Wednesday night trick-or-treating down at Colonial. You guys did a great job singing your songs, and I think you guys got lots of candy. Yeah, and so this, and we're not to Christmas yet, even though all the stores will tell you that. They kind of skip Thanksgiving. You can buy all that stuff 50% off now at Hobby Lobby because they're already decorating for Christmas. So you can get all your Thanksgiving stuff already on sale. But, you know, they skip Thanksgiving. But should we skip Thanksgiving?
No.
No, we shouldn't skip Thanksgiving because, you know, it's our time to be thankful. So this month, as we go through the month, there's lots of things to be faithful, to be thankful for. One is probably your parents. Okay. Another is this church. We should be thankful that we have this church to come to on Sunday mornings and on Wednesday nights. We should be thankful for a lot of the songs we're singing today. There's a purpose that we're thanking God. You know, if you listen to the songs, they are like give thanks. But one of the things we're thankful for are our farmers. And if you look out there, I bet you see some farmers. Okay, farmers, raise your hands. I know we got Rex chatting. I know we got the Williamses. We got the Ferrises up there. We've got some farmers in this church. And you know what? They're really important. We need to thank them. Because you know what they do for us? They provide our food for us. Without them, what would we have? So we need to make sure, you know, if you see them before you go to Sunday school, thank those farmers because it's really important what they do. They're a vital part of this community, too. Knox County is, you know, a farming community. So we need to make sure we thank them. You know who else? What else is coming up that we need to thank people for? On Saturday. Nope, Saturday is Veterans Day. And we'll probably do something next week to honor our veterans. But, okay, who's our veterans? I know we got Tim Magruder. I know we got Bruce Brown. We got some other veterans in here. We got Pastor Darren. We've got Gene Courtney. So we have some veterans out here, too. Oh, we got John Hedge over there. You know, and that's important, too. Because they serve our country. And a lot of them had to go places far away from their families, leave their families here, and go serve somewhere else. And, you know, so we got to make sure we thank them for that too. So we're going to say a prayer. So this week and this month, I want you to remember, number one, we thank God for everything we have. When I was growing up, a song that we sang a lot in church was Count Your Blessings, Name Them One by One. Count your blessings, see what God has done. So that's what I want you guys to do this week. Count your blessings, but name them, each one. Don't just say, thank you, God, for everything. Start naming every one of those blessings that he's given you. It could be this beautiful day that we're going to have today where it kind of warmed up after a few cold days. It sounds like November is going to be a little warmer for us, okay? So we're going to pray, and then we're going to walk to prayer and praise, and when we get back there, I have something for you, but I'm going to give it to you back in the narthex before you go to prayer and praise, okay? So repeat after me. Dear Lord, thank you for all the blessings you give us. Help us to name them one by one. In your name we pray. Amen. Okay, I will meet you back there.
I saw a baby monkey while I was out trick-or-treating.
You did?
A baby.
Well, if you've got your Bibles with you, we're going to start off in Genesis, but we're going to make a good trip through the Scriptures. So if you looked at the bulletin, there's a long list of stuff there. So we're talking about being tied to the land, and it's not just about food. It's not just about raising herd animals of one sort or another. It goes much deeper than that, but we're going to go back to creation here and find out just how we are tied to the land. So in Genesis chapter 2, right in the middle of verse 4, it says this: In the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens, when no plant of the field was yet in the earth and no herb of the field had yet sprung up, for the Lord had not caused it to rain upon the earth, and there was no one to till the ground, but a stream would rise from the earth and water the whole face of the ground. And then the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground, and he breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And the man became a living being. And the Lord planted a garden in Eden in the east, and there he put the man whom he had formed. And out of the ground the Lord God made to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food, and the tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. So lest we should ever get too big for our own britches, we should remember where we came from. Dirt. Maybe that's why boys spend most of their growing days covered in it. I don't know. And that's why mom spends so much time doing this. So we have a man formed in the out of the dust. But we're going to move up here now into chapter 3. Because we know what happened shortly after Adam was created. Then Eve was created. But they got themselves into trouble. They were told, as you recall, they could eat anything in there except from the one tree, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. But that did not work out so well, did it? And so here we find out what happened. So we move up to chapter 3, beginning in verse 17. And to the man he said, and this is God speaking to him, because you have listened to the voice of your wife and have eaten of the tree about which I commanded you, you shall not eat of it. Cursed is the ground because of you. So, if anybody ever has to fight weeds, right there's why. You ever notice that no matter how hard you try to grow stuff, it's difficult at times? But if you walk out in your driveway or someplace where there's cement or blacktop, there's weeds growing right up through that stuff. Didn't plant it, didn't water it, didn't feed it, but boy, it don't mind growing anywhere and everywhere. Well, right there's why. You shall not eat of that tree. I told you not to do it. And because of that, the ground is cursed because of you. In toil you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Thorns and thistles it shall bring forth for you, and you shall eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your face you shall eat bread until you return to the ground, for out of it you were taken. You are dust, and you shall return to dust. Well, there's life in a quick sentence or two, right? You start off as dust, it's going to cause, there's a lot of work, and then you die. Sound exciting, right? Problem is there are many in the world that think that's all there is to it, that that's where it stops. Well, I'll get the best out of what I can, and then I'll die, and I'll be gone, and then it'll be somebody else's problem. I've heard on more than one occasion, and I get it, someone said, well, I put the last roof on my house I'm ever going to have to put on there because it's going to last longer than I will. That's somebody else's deal. There is a bit of poeticness in this if you think about it. You know, God creates us out of the dirt, out of the dust, and then eventually that's what we become again in spite of what happens, you know, the embalming and all that other stuff. Dead, still dead. And if those things were opened up and we were exposed to the air, guess what? We'd be gone. Wouldn't take long. You are dust and you shall return. Now, the good news is that that is not where it ends, though. So we know the beginning. And the ending is literally we are connected to the ground. But what about everything that goes on in between? One major connection is a home for God's people, the promised land. Now this is going to eventually lead to us, but as God was raising up this nation, they too were connected to a particular place at a particular time. And so in Numbers chapter 13, verse 25 through 33, and this is at the end of the 40 days when the spies had returned from the land. They came to Moses and Aaron and to all the congregation of the Israelites in the wilderness of Paran at Kadesh. And they brought back word to them that all the congregation and showed them the fruit of the land. And they told them, we came to the land to which you sent us. It flows with milk and honey, and this is its fruit. Yet the people who live in the land are strong. The towns, they're fortified. Excuse me there. Their towns are fortified. And we saw very large individuals there. We saw the descendants of Anak there. The Amalekites live in the land of the Negeb. The Hittites, the Jebusites, the Amorites. They live in the hill country of the Canaanites, and I should say, the Canaanites live by the sea along the Jordan. So there's a lot of folks living out there. But Caleb quieted the people before Moses, and he said, let's go up and let's occupy the land at once, for we are able to overcome it. Then the men who had gone up with him said, we are not able to go up against this people, for they are stronger than we are. Excuse me. Boy, I coughed right into that. That didn't help. Think about that a minute. We can look at what comes before us and say we can either overcome it through God or it's going to overcome us. Which would we choose? As soon as there was any kind of resistance, potential resistance, or an obstacle that seemed greater than they just said, well, we can't do that. Forgetting all the miracles God had just done for them on their journey out of Egypt. Caleb says, let's go up. But the other says, no, we can't. They're stronger than we are. So they brought to the Israelites an unfavorable report of the land that they had spied out, saying, the land that we have gone through as spies is a land that devours its inhabitants, and all the people that we saw in it are great size. We saw the Nephilim, the Anakites from the Nephilim, and to ourselves we seem like grasshoppers, and so we seem to them. So these would be descendants of Goliath, in case you're wondering. So they see that obstacle. No, we can't go, can't do it. And how many of us in our walk of faith, when we're looking around and seeing the things that are coming before us, go, oh, I was all excited. We wanted to go do this. And then as soon as we begin to see how much effort it's going to take, it's like, well, you know, maybe we won't do that. Let's go do something easier. Let's go do something that doesn't require so much effort. But is that what God calls us to? Imagine if Christ said that as he knew the cross was moving ever closer. Or actually, literally, he was moving ever closer to it. If you look through Matthew, it's a nice travelogue as Jesus moves from town to town to town with one thing on his mind, getting to that cross. He knew where he was going, and he was very deliberate about getting there. He didn't allow the obstacles to hold him back. Their lack of faith and their disobedience to God came with a consequence, as we all know, with, of course, an intercession from Moses. So if we jump to Numbers 14, beginning in verse 19, we find Moses in prayer to the Lord. Forgive the iniquity of this people according to the greatness of your steadfast love. Just as you have pardoned the people, pardoned this people from Egypt even until now. And then the Lord said, I do forgive, just as you have asked. Nevertheless, as I live, and as all the earth shall be filled with the glory of the Lord, none of the people who have seen my glory and the signs that I did in Egypt and in the wilderness, and yet have tested me these 10 times and have not obeyed my voice, shall not see the land that I swore to give to their ancestors. But my servant Caleb, because he has different spirit and has followed me wholeheartedly, I will bring into the land into which he went, and his descendants shall possess it. There is a consequence when we choose the easy road. And in their case, they just about lost everything. The fact that they even still had a relationship with God was a blessing in and of itself. But the promise that they had been coming to receive, they essentially just told God, no thanks, I don't want your promise. And he said, fine, you're not getting it. You're going to go wander in the wilderness, and then when you're all dead, we'll bring your descendants in. Does that describe our walk in any way? Are we the one to go forward to face whatever comes in faith, or would we rather sit back, say, well, we'll just see what happens? Our ties to the land, as we see, they were tied to the land. They would lose it, they would gain it, they would lose it, they would gain it over the years, but there's always been a place. And if you think about it, there's no other place in the world where so many people want to get rid of such a small nation. Over the centuries, they've been trying to get rid of them. What is so important about that little chunk of land, that little spot, that there's such hatred that they have to be removed from it? And yet they have never been fully removed from it. There's always been a faithful remnant. Always. If God is not in there, why is it such a big deal? Because there's a lot of other nicer places around the world besides that chunk of ground right there. But it should remind us that God is involved, for sure. But our land, our ties to the land continue as we move into the New Testament, because not only were they tied, but then God's people become tied to it as well. As people tied to the harvest of the land for our survival, Jesus uses this to remind us of an even greater harvest yet to come. This greater harvest he speaks of points out our role in it as well as our reward in it. After Jesus taught about the weeds in a field, he explained its full meaning to his disciples. So there are fields, they have the harvest, it's grown up with weeds. a parable that most didn't get, but Jesus explains it to his disciples in Matthew 13, verse 36 through 43. Then he left the crowds and went into the house, and his disciples approached him, saying, "Explain to us the parable of the weeds of the field." And he answered, "The one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed are the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the children of the evil one, and the enemy who sowed them is the devil." Notice God makes a very clear distinction between those that are his and those that are of the enemy. There are those that are good, there are those that are evil. And again, the world does not want to hear that. The world doesn't want to accept that. And the world certainly doesn't want us running around telling them that. The harvest is at the end of the age, and the reapers are angels. Just as the weeds are collected and burned up with the fire, so it will be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels. They will collect out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all evildoers, and they will throw them into the furnace of fire, where there'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Let anyone who has ears hear and listen. Now Jesus expands on this theme of the resurrection a little more in the book of Mark in chapter 4, 26 through 29. He had said this, "The kingdom of God as if someone would scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how. The earth produces of itself, first the stalk and then the head, the full grain in the head. But when the grain is ripe, at once he goes out with his sickle because the harvest has come." And speaking more about the kingdom of God down in verse 30 of Mark 4, he also said, "With what can we compare the kingdom of God? Or what parable will we use for it? It is like a mustard seed, which, when sown upon the ground, is the smallest of seeds on earth, and yet, when it is sown, it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs and puts forth branches so that the birds of the air can make their nests in its shade." Ultimately, what God plants within us, and through God, what we help plant in others, grows beyond the humble state it began in. The kingdom of God becomes a place where all may find eternal life if they give their hearts to the Lord and repent of their sins, so we can be part of that harvest of the righteous. Jesus spoke of the necessity of each of us serving in our part in this great harvest to come. Matthew chapter 9, verse 35 through 38. Jesus then went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom of God, and curing every disease and sickness. And when he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." How many lost sheep are around us? How many lost sheep are in our own families? And how many of these lost sheep are we actively trying to help them find their way to the Lord? The necessity for us to be sharing the word and interacting with the people so that they can be guided to that door to knock so that Jesus can invite them in is very real. It's required. It's necessary. There are so many that are lost. There are so many that are distracted. There are so many that are caught up with what they think the world thinks about them, that they haven't heard what Jesus thinks about them. That he loves them. He cares for them. He wants to see them healed of whatever might be going on inside their heart, what might be going on inside their spirit, what might be going on inside their mind. To let them know they are loved, they are valuable, that God considers them to be valuable in his eyes, of great value, of great price. So much so that he gave his son for their lives so that they could be brought into the family of God. But how many of them never hear? How many of them don't hear because we don't bother to share it? Remember what Adam and Eve were told back in Genesis 19b. If you are dust, and to dust you shall return. And of course, the enemy of all believers, Satan, stands in the way to distract, deceive, and lie to the people so that they will not turn to Jesus, but rather even turn against him. He's actively doing that. And if you have family and friends and neighbors who are so busy with the world, so distracted by the world, don't have time for God, don't believe in Christ, don't want to hear about it, guess who's winning his little part of the battle at that particular moment in that particular life? And the question then comes, what are we doing to help change that? What influence are we having in the lives of these people around us who are looking for solid men and women of God who believe the truth of what Christ says and what's in the Bible and lives it daily, all the time? People are looking for those that they can look up to. They might not even know it. And certainly the young people in our lives are looking up to us and scratching their head at times and going, well, what's up with that? Because they look at us and they see people that say one thing and do another. Well, it's not important for mom or dad to go to Bible study. I guess I don't need to go to Bible study. Maybe I don't need to be in youth group. Maybe I don't need to go to Sunday school. Hey, I know. Let's go out early for lunch. Oh, there's a ball game. Let's go do that. There's a football game. Let's go see that. All sorts of things to do. But if we're not setting the example, then we're letting them down and we're just opening up the door for Satan to come in here. Help yourself with my family because they're probably lost anyway. Oh, well. From dust we were made, to dust we will return. But that's not the end. Because when Christ and his angels come and that harvest is taken up, those who have found Christ will find eternal life. Those who don't are going to find an eternal lake of fire where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth eternally. No redemption from there, no being saved from there, no second chances from there. That's it, you're done, kaput, it's over. What are we doing to help in that harvest? Of course, Peter warned us in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 3 through 13. First of all, you must understand this, that in the last days, scoffers will come, scoffing and indulging in their own lusts. Anybody see that in the last week? And they are saying, where is the promise of his coming? Well, Jesus didn't come in the last 1,000 years, didn't come in the last 2,000 years. Chances are he won't be coming back in the next 1,000 years, so probably doesn't exist and I don't have to worry about it. For ever since our ancestors died, he goes on to say, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation. They deliberately ignore this fact that by the word of God, heavens existed long ago and earth was formed out of water and by the means of water, through which the world of that time was deluged with water and perished. But by the same word, the present heavens and the earth have been reserved for fire, being kept until the day of judgment and the destruction of the godless. But do not ignore this one fact. Do not ignore this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord one day is like 1,000 years and 1,000 years is like one day. Just a little side note, that is not a mathematical equation that we can go back and check. Okay, well, it's been 1,000 years, that was one day for God. Now we can figure out how old everything is. He's just letting us know this simple fact, that time has no meaning in God's perspective. That's all that means. So just because it seems like a long time to us, to God, it's nothing but a heartbeat. And so he is waiting for that right time to return so that none of us may be lost. He's giving us every opportunity, generation after generation, to repent of our sins and come to him. And for those of us who are already in the flock, to be those shepherds, to help lead those lost sheep back to Christ. Verse 7, but the same word that the by the same word, the present heavens and the present earth have been reserved for fire. All right, moving on down to 9. The Lord is not slow about his promise, as some think of slowness. Again, time has no meaning for God. But he is patient with us, not wanting any to perish, but for all to come to repentance. We've said it. Think about the patience God had to have with each and every one of us before we were really serious enough to repent of our sins and commit ourselves to living for him. And how many of us are still in that process of trying to figure, well, what does it mean to really commit my life to Christ? Is it just what I do on Sunday morning, or is it every day? Am I reading the scripture? Am I praying? Am I with him and worshiping him all the time? He's not slow, but he's patient with us. He doesn't want us to perish, but he wants us to all repent. Verse 10, but the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a loud noise, and the elements will be dissolved with fire, and the earth and everything that is done on it will be disclosed. See, there's the thing. Once the judgment comes and those final judgments were made, there won't be any more questions. Everybody went up, well, I guess it was real. But it'll be too late. It'll be too late. It will all be disclosed. Since all these things are to be dissolved in this way, what sort of person ought you to be in leading lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God? We know it's happening. We know it's coming. What are we doing to prepare? We heard Lori earlier talking about Thanksgiving and the idea, you know, that Christmas isn't far away and people are already planning for that, leastways the stores are. And there's been a few out there, I think we've seen putting up lights because it was warm. Didn't want to do it when it was cold. Yeah, we prepare for these little things. But do we prepare for the greatest thing that will ever happen? Are we prepared for it? Because again, dust to dust, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, we never know when our last moment's going to be, and then it'll be too late for us to have any impact on anybody else. To have an active impact on them. Since all these things are to be dissolved in this way, what sort of person ought we to be? Leading lives of holiness and godliness, waiting and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set ablaze and dissolved, and elements will melt with fire. But in accordance with his promise, we wait for new heavens and a new earth, where righteousness is at home. And there's our hope. There's the hope we can offer those around us who sometimes look at life and go, I don't have any hope. I don't have anything at all. We are intricately tied to the land, physically and spiritually, from dust to dust. from the old earth to the new earth, the eternal kingdom. There's a sowing and harvesting that feeds the mortal body, and there's a spiritual sowing and reaping that leads to eternal life. The question, as we've mentioned already a couple times, that we need to ponder and think through and answer every day is, what sort of person will we be leading a life of holiness and godliness as we wait for the coming day of the Lord? So let's enter into a time of prayer to answer that question. And in addition, let's also consider, if there's someone we know who God is laying on our heart, who needs to have a relationship with Jesus, maybe we could bring their name down to the altar today to pray, to lift them up specifically before the Lord. Now, we're going to be taking communion, so that's going to give us a great opportunity to come down here. Please be sure to take turns. But come, kneel if you can, stand if you must. But if you know somebody that God has laid on your heart that needs to find Jesus, when we make our petition before God, take some time. Lay their name here. And then at that same time, begin to ask, God, how can I help lead this person to you? What is the role you want me to play? What is the thing you need me to say or do to help them find the hope that we now have? And if those are going to help serve the communion, if you would come forward at this time as they prepare the table. Heavenly Father, Lord, we know life can be very short. And even in the longest life that we might have here, to you, it is but a moment. But what we do in between has eternal consequences. First, of course, for ourselves. And so if we have not asked you into our heart, Lord, we want to repent of our sins and ask Jesus to come into our heart today so that we could be his son or daughter. But also, Lord, the influence that we could have to help others find you, those lost sheep that need to be directed back to their eternal shepherd. And so, Father, we give you praise and thanksgiving for this opportunity to come before you. And we thank you for Christ. We ask for your blessing upon these elements. May they be for us the body and blood of Christ, reminding us of all that he did. As on that night when he was betrayed, he took the bread and broke it and said, "This is my body given for you." And likewise, after the meal, taking the cup and giving thanks, saying, "This is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you and many for the forgiveness of sins." They were told to take and eat and drink and offer as they would in remembrance of him. And so, Lord, today we remember and we give you praise and we give you thanks. The blood of Christ. Once you've been served, you may go and find the trays and the bread. We do have the small waste cans set aside. We want you to know that this table is an open table for all who call upon Christ as their Lord and Savior. So as you feel led, you are welcome to come. And we will have gluten-free down here in the center. Bread on the left, juice on the right. And you may come as the Lord leads you.
Heavenly Father,
We very much have a treat this morning, as the brass ensemble will be helping to lead this last selection for the beauty of the earth. And I'm sure that most all of you know it. And so let us rise and lift our voices in song and worship our Lord Jesus Christ and continue to give him praise.
Now may God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless you and keep you now and forevermore. Amen and amen.